the principle, the experience of Kabbalah Seyam Acho Shamay. This is the Indian from Shema that precedes Goyim Shemeya. Where there is just the principle of Kabbalah Seyam Acho Shamay, there is not any ramifications, any result of it. I said, we'll start in the top line of Kuf Nun Zayin. It's not someplace. The Kabbalah says Malchus Shemayim, Malchus Yisborich, he says, this Rotzen, Rak accepts She'eine be his Galus HaRotzen. There's a Rotzen therein, for the reason the Yisgalus HaRotzen expressed in this Kabbalah says. What do you mean by Yisgalus HaRotzen? If there is a Rotzen that pushes it. So he says, in the Gaza Rosen, the beginning is Tzio Mehadog. Mehadog. His Gaza Rosen means that the Rosen is pushing him and drawing him out of his complacency, so to speak. Abu Yeish was a Rosen because of the Taki Benefish. But there is a strong Rosen in that. And what is the, how is the strength of this rotz identifiable? If it is not, if it does not activate him and push him to some kind of a action. So he explains. Din is galzon rotzin who be spoiled by nefesh. The principle of his galus orotzen, orotzen is, so to speak, announcing itself. Then there is poros benefesh. His poros means a true, a noticeable, identifiable excitement. Thank you. Ubi tzio migeder kei. To the extent that it draws him out of the realm of Kali. Rotzoi is a koyach makifi. Koyach makifi cannot be contained in Kali. So if the Rotzoi is Bisgalus, then that is manifest in the fact that he is not containing Kali. Mitzia migeder Kali. We say Mitzia migeder Kali. Gather means definition of. Gather means a fence. Just like a fence that demarcates an area. And this demarcation separates this area from the rest of the space outside of it. So gather came. But Fabrenian, somebody says, L'chaim. There's no other way to say L'chaim but to take mashke in a cup. That's okay. So if his intake of mashke is measured according to the keli, then he is in gather keli. There's no way that he can bypass the keli. But the point is, how many times does he repeat this take? If he loses count of it, then he is not begetter keli, even though he is still using the keli to feed himself. There's a Fabrengen from Rebbe Rashab. This is the last week that Rebbe Dis wasn't feeling well. And he took a lot of mashke. And Rebbe Sinivke, his mother, came to him and she said, she's thinking as if I shouldn't drink so much. Du feels doch nicht gut. Du dir nicht gut. In Yiddish, she said, du dir nicht gut. You have a negative feeling. You're not well. So the Rebbe screamed out, mir is nicht gut. Mir is sehr gut. And in fact, he took an excessive amount of mashke. And whether it's to be related or not, but the fact was that within a week, there was a tragic thing. Whether it has a shaykhus with the mashke or not. But he was, it was mitzi and migyadr keil. This is the effect of rots.
What happened within a week?
Huh?
What happened within a week?
Business, yeah.
So this was the last from rain?
Huh?
This was by the last from rain?
Yeah. Fala Sefer from
Rifkin.
Uh-huh.
Schaff to the Rebbe.
After that.
He writes him?
Yeah, I could have saved it. Rifkin. He was in Shamash Rebbe last week. And he recorded every detail.
What was the occasion on that Fabrengen?
I don't remember. So, his galus are rotzin. The rotzin is there all the time. And there it says, even with koyach nelam, yeish bazer rotzin. And there is an inherent of Kabbalah Seh Machus and Machus Shomayim. As we spoke yesterday, we said, Kabbalah Seh Machus Shomayim is a clear, a defining factor, in it. Just as a human being does not need to be alert that he has to walk on 2 feet. Don't crawl on 4. That's the design of a human being. Kabbalah Seh Machus Shomayim by Yid, this is part of his design. He does not identify the koyach that directs him there. So even though there is Kabbalah Seh Machus and Machus Shomayim, but it's not because Galus HaRotz. The ratzon is not announcing itself. If the ratzon would be announcing itself, then that would take him out, beget the cave. But here, any bizgal got to begin to see Tim Hadu. I will yes, but the ratzon chosuk betaki benefesh. I'm going back and forth. I'm going to, okay. Let's go back to the third line. Even the Kabbalah says Machshumayim of Rosh Hashanah. Again, the emphasis over here is the words of Kabbalah Soil Machshumayim. Kabbalah Soil Machshumayim is an inherent aspect in a Yid. He is a Yid, especially is a Kabbalah Soilik. But the Kabbalah and the Kabbalah soil, Punayin is not a pronounced activity. It is part and parcel of his makeup. Even the Kabbalah soil, Machashumayim, the Rosh Hashanah, the Hub is Gal was on Rotz, where there is clearly an announced Rotz, because this is the Aveda that he is doing, Kabbalah soil, Machashumayim. And nonetheless, Ein Zebi is Paulus Benefesh. Ein Zebi is Paulus Benefesh. Even at Rosh Hashanah, there is not the Inyan Kabbalah Seyem Machashamayim, but he's Paulus Benefesh. In an exciting manner. He knows what he is doing. There isn't that aspect. Kiyim. What then is the expression of Gili Horotz of Kabbalah Seyem Achashamayim? Rishon is Gili Horotz. Kiim rather who bibchines misino un sinai b'chol atzmusoi. It expresses itself in the fact that in misino un misino un sinai he is dedicating himself b'chol atzmusoi, his entire self. Shemei ser v'neisim kol atzmus atzmei. He is dedicating his whole self or mahusoi and his entire mahus. I mean, the other the name was mahus means entire, all his capabilities. Lelakus. Tonakus. Every one of his functional abilities recognizes the union of Alakos. The whole beginning of the nafsh. And this dedication is regil of the nafsh, is something that is identifiable. He knows that he is dedicated. The Kabbalah says, "Machshemayim bechol hashono." Ain't the beginning of them. Throughout the year, there is a Kabbalah says, "Machshemayim," but ain't the beginning of them. It is not a self-standing. It's not something that he identifies with. Every day in the morning, he gets up and he washes negolasa and says brachas. He does not, at that point, experience the union that he is a Neved Hashem. He does this thing that he knows he has to do. I'm not saying Mitzvah Noshim Olamode, he's not aware of what he's doing. He's aware of what he's doing, but there's nothing strong also compelling him to do it and recognizing what he is doing. So the Chol Hashanah ain't a begil of nefesh. We can also say Machashman the Rosh Hashanah who begil of nefesh. And Rosh Hashanah Kabbalah Seil is begil of nefesh. He is in full expression. The focus on Rosh Hashanah is Kabbalah Seil. A Yid, let's say, is always learning. It's a time to learn. Throughout the year, he's also learning to Hashem and he knows that this is the right thing to do. But he is also involved and focused on knowing what he is learning. There is a, so to speak, a personal involvement, a personal gain. By learning, he gets to know this thing that he learned. A Hirshon when he learns, that aspect is totally, he's totally oblivious to. The action of learning, which is a mitzvah, this is what preoccupies him. Not the personal gain out of it. So, throughout the year, the Inyan of Kabbalah Soil, Machu Shemayim, is altogether not felt. He's doing his thing. Kabbalah Tei Machu Shemayim, the Rosh Hashanah, the Gil of the Nefesh. And Rosh Hashanah, the Kabbalah Soil, is experience, is known. But this Gilui is not in a manner of Yitzhiyah Megedr Keli, of losing himself, so to speak, and losing control of the normalcy of his action. Even though it's a Kabbalah saying Rosh is begil of an avshah, but not begin to see him together, Katie. Or Mekomokoim, but still. So this is, so to speak, a subtle in explaining the Kabbalah sale of Rosh Hashanah. It's begilui, but not a gilui that breaks down all his boundaries. Even though there is a limit, so to speak, to this gil, any together, together, kill me, come, okay, still, have a Kabbalah, still, Machoshimayim, the Rosh Hashanah, a Kabbalah, he, Berotzin, Chosu, Benepesh. The Kabbalah is a clear experience, Rotzin, Chosu, Benepesh. There's a powerful push, Rosh Hashanah, the Kabbalah, say, Machoshimayim. And this is where we came to the other day. We ought to repeat it and focus it. Biodua gamke. It is also known the Ba'avedas Eved, that in the Aveda and the labor and the service of an Eved, yeish bazeh tainuk. There is therein tainuk, not only a rotz, but tainuk. An actual satisfaction. And what is the tainuk? He's an avid. An avid means he's doing what he is told to do. And he's not doing it because he likes it, but because he's an avid. He's completely subservient. And what is the tainuk? The tainuk is Masha Mashim Rotzin Ha'odin. And the fact that he is mashlim, he fulfills, he satisfies the rotzin ha'odoin, the will of the master. In other words, he himself is not involved in this which he's doing at all. He doesn't appreciate the significance and the value of what he's doing. But since that this is the Rosenhod, and he has the opportunity to fulfill the Rosenhod, this gives him oinik. Because the Eved is in total submission to the order. He is one thing with the order. And therefore, the fact that he is the one who is mashlim, who completes the rotzon of the order, that is his oin. It sounds more simple than it is. The meaning of timing, oinag, which is translated on the simplest level, pleasure, and pleasure is not at all touching the meaning from timing that we're talking about. Because pleasure is something which is identifiable distinctly from the person. He has a pleasure from experiencing a certain thing. Tainug is not a pleasure. More correctly, between translation, I said delight. Tainug is something, is an internal and neshama experience.
What is delight?
Excuse me?
What is delight different than pleasure?
Oh. Let's take an extra dictionary.
What are you saying the difference is?
Delight. When a person hardly, right? If somebody eats something very tasty. Ah, oh, it's so good. That's pleasure. If something is delightful, delightful means that it touches him and it calms him down. He's not going to express it. Ah, this is, there's no ah. This touches, so to speak, the essence of his life's experience. So the Eved has time, which is not a pleasure. This is, you can't hear pleasure. He's laboring, he's working hard. Can't have the pleasure. But beneath all, he is delighted. He is elated personally that he was able to be mashlim, he was able to complement the will of the master. Because the master to him, this is what his life is all about. Like we mentioned the other day, the story of Eliezer Eved Avraham. He put in a tremendous effort in this whole trip. We discussed the other day. But he couldn't allow himself to take a morsel of food until he fulfilled his mission. That's what the Rebbe says, Ba'aveda Sabbath Yesh Ba'aseh Taim. Okay, I wanted to explain the infant time. Tainug, rotzon and oinag, we all know that rotzon and oinag are the two keeps and makipi. Kirkus makipi. Let's discuss this for a moment. Who needs a kochas makifim? You function with your kochas pnimi, with action. Who needs kochas makifim? Amen. Yes, we'll put my kirk, my kirk on the side. We always say that this world is identified, everything in the world is identified by Mokim and Zman, place and time. Place and space and time, place and time is a prerequisite for anything to happen in the world. Now, this prerequisite can be understood in two ways. One is, if you didn't have place for this cup, you couldn't have a cup of water. The fact that he has a place does not contribute to what it is. It's enables it to be. In that case, this is what we call in America fast food. Fast food is also in a cup, but it has no place. It is not found at any place. You grab it and you run off. It still occupies place, but it's not occupying it, it's not set in place. When you have the same food set on the table and you sit down around it, it's exactly the same food. But then this food is grasping. The food is grasping the place and time during which it is being consumed. Then you identify, what are you doing? I'm having a meal. This place and time is extremely important because the place and time is the makif and makif level of existence in the world. Everything that exists in the world has to have place and time. So there's these two versions of this. It has to have a place and time. Even just to be its limited union, it has to have place and time, otherwise it couldn't exist. Then there is union, the place and time is part and parcel of its existence. When the place and time is part and parcel of its existence, it is enriched. Then it's really an experience. There's a difference between a meal, a suda, or a fast food. In terms of the consumption of the food, it's the same thing. Bachasan, you don't keep people to eat, you give them a soup. And everybody has his place. And a place card. And if he doesn't have a place card, he feels uncomfortable. Why not? I'm going to have the food.
But in Chayre, Tainug, what you call delight would be something like Svaratzen.
It's something what?
Like in Hebrew equivalent of Svaratzen. But here, he's using the Lashon of Oynig. Oynig does express a form of pleasure. Not only satiation. I don't know what to have right.
Satiation.
Svarotin, each one of these is a little.
I'm just trying to look for the equivalent of delight in Hebrew. What would be the equivalent of delight in Hebrew?
Tainug.
No, The Rebbe says, yes, but the Tainug expresses a form of pleasure. Einig is a form of pleasure.
No.
Einig is not a form of pleasure.
Tainug ha-nefesh is not pleasure. Tainug ha-cheich of the palate is a pleasure. Einig ha-nefesh is not a called pleasure.
So what is it?
So let me complete what I started telling you, the value of tainug, and then we'll come back. Just like he said, the cup has to have a place to be, otherwise it couldn't be. But there's a difference between whether it is in holding water and you're holding it in your hand, but you have no place to put it down, or there is a place that is dedicated for it. Then it is occupying space. This occupying space gives it a sense of belonging. It belongs there. It owns the place. It's a real presence. It owns the place that it occupies. So then it is not just a stranger intruding upon the world. The world is actually providing for it. And says you belong here. This belonging is an in of oinik. In other words,
you said a long time ago that tainuk is that which is worthy to tainuk. The expression of tainuk is that which is worthy to experience.
Worthy
to experience.
Worthy to experience.
That's, if I remember.
Okay.
I mean, I wrote it down. I mean to say, but. Then also bother me, isn't oinig a form of epis pleasure? What does it have to do with worthy of royal?
Okay, so
worthy of experience.
So let me,
is
let
something
me.
Is a ruchnistike.
Okay, so let me explain.
The nefesh doesn't have an enjoyment, a real, like we understand a physical enjoyment. Worthy of experience is a good cause, but it's not an enjoyable experience.
Right. Say worthy of experience is a completely different thing. Worthy of experience means that it connects you to something, to a different reality. We said all the time the difference between somebody coming into a feast or a wedding, and there is food galore. There's no. A limit to the food, and he comes in and starts eating along with everybody else. And the difference between an invited guest and an uninvited guest. The food is the same. But the invited guest has a completely different experience from this food. He experiences not only the food, but the welcome aspect. This welcome aspect, this is the oinag that we're talking about. This places him in internal to this event, and the makif of this event. Not only the activity of it, but the makif of it. Why is this event there in the first place? He is part of that why. That's the makif. So an avid, a dedicated avid, who has, so to speak, dedicated, abandoned himself to the service of the Mordei, his delight, his sense,
about
Einig. Yeah, I don't know. His delight is, hello, you're disturbing our learning here. Thank you. His delight is not due to a personal experience. It's due to the fact that he is accepted and incorporated in the overall truth of what's happening. That means that he identifies his whole mitzvahs with that of the order. Mishnah of the Rebbe says that Eved has this tainuk, not only rotzon, but tainuk. We see that the big tainuk, rotzon, there could be an aspect of explanation, whereas tainuk can be based on explanation. Tainuk is only when there is a complete unity.
Again, because when you think about Hashkof and Hashem, when you think about the Eved, what he feels is accomplishment, a certain form of Sviyas Ratzon.
What?
Eved, what he feels accomplishment, that he feels good about what he's doing.
No.
He feels a validation of his existence.
No. He experiences the validity of his action along with the other, together with the other. The other is happy, he is happy. Thinking of an example of experience. Mash mashlim rotzon ha'od. Mashlim rotzon ha'od. Mashlim means he completes. He completes the rotzon ha'od. It means like this: the Odin has a rotzon. He wants something to happen. This rotzon requires that something should be done, that it should happen. This happening doesn't happen automatically because he wants it, that's when it happens. The Mashem Rotzon Hoden has to be brought about. And this being, and the Odin wants it to be the Mokimun's mouth. Let's go back to the example of Mokimun's mouth. Let's say he serves the Odin his meal. And the Odin eats. The Eved is not only providing the Odin with the food, he's providing the Odin with the food in a manner that the Odin appreciates the service with how it's presented to him. In other words, there is not just the food, but the hashlom of rotzon ha'odin. Rotzon ha'odin is that the food should be presented properly. And he is mashlim rotzon ha'odin. This is the delight of the Eved. This delight, mashlim rotzon ha'odin, is not something which is a seichel. He is not really contributing anything. If he serves him the food, okay, he's not hungry anymore. But he serves him the food in a certain way that gives him a certain sense of recognition and honor and so forth. This is not part of the desire of food. And he is master of the Lord. This gives him delight. The fact that he is able to serve the other in an honorable and respectful manner, that itself gives him delight. Not just that he served him and he's not hungry. And this is the time of the oining of the event. The Odin has experiences oinag in this union, and the Evad experiences the same oinag.
What do we say was lacking in the ratzon?
The ratzon Rotzen and Oinag are both Kofas Makifi. Makifi. Oinag is an insider, and Rotzen is an outsider. We have this situation that we discussed many times. You invite somebody to be your guest for lunch. He comes and he sits down and you serve him a hefty lunch. He looks at the lunch and he says, "Ah, thank you, beautiful food. I'll take it in my basket and I'll go home and eat it in my kitchen." The same food, but he is lacking, he is missing the whole point of this invitation. His rotzon could be serviceable, but not his oinag. The oinag is only when it is encompassed within the makif. Okay, this, as much as we'll talk, there'll still be something left to be said. So, b'zehu inyan simcha shel mitzvah. This oinag is the principle of simcha shel mitzvah, the simcha of doing a mitzvah. Which means the mekim amitzvah mepeyam mamosh, that when a person does a mitzvah mepeyam mamosh in simple action, so echliyis b'zin b'zas simcha. In that action, doing that activity, there has to be a yom simcha. Clearly, the action is the focus of the whole activity, and yet he's saying there's something missing if there is not simcha. This is something new that we come into. As it says in the pasuk, "Tachas Hashem le'yavadeto, Hashem alekecha b'simcha v'tuvli." This is in the toichacha. In the toichacha, it says that you'll be driven out of your place, tachas, because of the fact that le'yavadeto Hashem alekecha b'simcha v'tuvli. You had all the brachas that are providing for you, and you were not, you did avein Hashem, but not besimcha. Le'avad Hashem besimcha to blame. Therefore, you're going to lose it. What is the simcha to do with the avein? The simcha is where the avein is connected with his master. He's not just doing that which he is obligated to do. but he is experiencing the phenomenal that he is a servant of his master, and that gives him delight and simcha. Now we're going in the details of simcha, so that's not for now. But nonetheless, sufficiently here, we recognize. I just wanted that we should understand how the makif goes along into the pnimi. A pnimi that lacks the makif, like I said, you're drinking a cup of water, but you don't have a place for it. You have to run around while you're drinking. You're missing the experience of this drink, even though the drink itself is the same. You don't have the accommodation that says, yes, you should drink and you have the right to drink. That doesn't happen. And that is the oinek and the rotzin in this afternoon. I think this is it, right? What time do we have to back it?
Yeah.
Sipik is an anavim. Sipik anefesh. Similar to oinek. Sipik.
Similar to anefesh?
Sipik. Sipok.
Sipok.
But that's more, Sipuk is more along the lines of Svarot.
Take it as a...